Welcome to Yung Tuition. This is a unique channel to explore, study, and share the basic issues in physics and beyond. Let's continue discussing basic issues in climate physics today. In my previous video, I quantitatively demonstrated that the proportion of the infrared absorption by carbon dioxide gas from terrestrial radiation is less than 10%, in line with the early analysis by Clew Armstrong. Now, I'm going to report a new evidence in support of my conclusion. To begin with, let's have a close look at the experimental study by John Tyndall, the Irish physicist who first measured the infrared absorption by water vapor and carbon dioxide. Many people on both sides of the debate on global warming may well consider him as the first to demonstrate the greenhouse effect in the atmosphere. But it would appear no one would have paid enough attention to his original lecture to reveal the proportion of CO2 infrared absorption. This is a Tyndall's experimental setup you might have seen, but here are some details. This long tube was used to keep a gas to be measured, whose amount and pressure could be adjusted and measured while those valves and gas supply and the mercury gauge, which has nothing to do with Young-Mills gauge theory. The infrared radiation intensity was measured by using a thermopile, or a thermo-electric pile to be exact. The state-of-art radiation detector in the 19th century. Here, a galvanometer was used to accurately measure the deflection of the needle, whose angle can be calibrated as absorption by the gas. Of special importance is the infrared source in Tyndall's experiment, called the Nesne cube, with boiling water in it. He tried relatively high temperature sources to enhance the radiation intensity, but he eventually used boiling water with a constant temperature to stabilize his measurement. This implies this radiation source was almost equivalent to the Earth's surface because the Planck functions at 288 Kelvin and 373 Kelvin are similar, as shown in this diagram. By definition, radiation absorption is a passive process during which some photons from the radiation source are consumed by atoms or molecules in a sample. But the absorptivity must be less than unit. Ideally, the intensity of radiation source should be kept independent of the wavelength, giving a uniform distribution. The reason is rather simple, because in this way, the actual absorption spectra of a sample can be easily obtained without fixing the baseline. Here is the infrared absorption spectra of CO2 that was simulated by the perpendicular pronoun I using decimals. The absorption peaks appear upside down compared with the emission spectra. Notice that there are three major absorption peaks or bands in the CO2 infrared spectra at 15, 4.3, and 2.7 microns, respectively. The corresponding wave numbers are also given to facilitate our discussing. In many reported CO2 infrared absorption, nevertheless, an infrared source is often far from uniform, such as the terrestrial radiation described by a Planck function with mean surface temperature 288 Kelvin. In this case, only one of the three CO2 absorption peaks at 15 micron or 667 per centimeter could be readily observed. As a result, this characteristic CO2 absorption peak or band should be treated as an indicator of the CO2 absorption from the terrestrial radiation. At 373 Kelvin, the boiling point of water, another CO2 absorption peak at 4.3 micron shows up. So, strictly speaking, the detected CO2 absorption in Tyndall's experiment is slightly different from the actual value in the atmosphere. Before Tyndall did his experiment, nobody knew whether or not the so-called radiant heat emitted from the Earth's surface could be absorbed by any constituent of the atmosphere, although Fourier and others speculated so. It was found that the quantity of the aquiline vapor diffused through the atmosphere produced an absorption at least 13 times that the dry atmosphere itself. Notice that Tyndall didn't mention CO2 in relation to climate, although he did measure the absorption of carbonic acid or CO2 as shown here. I was about to introduce Tyndall's experimental results one by one, which would be a little bit boring, when I suddenly had a new idea. Why don't I just find the relevant data to estimate the proportion of CO2 infrared absorption, as I discussed before? Let's go.
First, I'm looking for the absorption by carbon dioxide in his experiment. It's olefined gas. That is one. Benzyl, no. Alcohol, no. Aha, here it is. The CO2 absorption, carbonic oxide or CO2. The maximum absorption in his experiment is 17.5. Next, I need to find the total infrared radiation used by Tyndall. I remember I saw it. Where are we? Let's go to the beginning. Aha, here it is. The total amount of heat passing through the exhausted tube was 75 degrees in deflection. It's equivalent to, the deflection of the 75 degrees is equivalent to 360 units of his absorption. So, 70 divided by 360 equal to 0.047 or close to 5%. That is the estimate proportion of CO2 infrared absorption from Tyndall's data. This is amazing. Yes, my estimate is supported by Tyndall's experiment in 1861. In fact, Tyndall was more concerned about basic issues in physics than climate. For example, he first used the term oscillating atoms to interpret the observed infrared absorption by gases. Today, we know the origin of the CO2 absorption spectra is due to the molecular vibration, rotation, and bending. Amazing, isn't it? In addition, Tyndall also experimentally investigated how heated gases emit radiant heat in space, as he observed. The absorptive power of the vapor referred to is very great, and its radiative power is equally so. This sounds his observation were consistent with Kirchhoff's law on thermal radiation, but it may merely mean
emission is proportional to absorption, not necessarily equal to the absorption, as I proposed in my recent paper. He went on by asking, what are the specific quantities which cause one body to radiate copiously and another feebly? Why, on the theoretical grounds, must the equivalency of radiation and absorption exist? How heat conducted? Why should good conductors be, in general, bad radiators, and bad conductor, good radiators? Wow, no climate scientist nowadays would care such fundamental questions. Despite some of these questions still remain theoretically unclear, such as the taken-for-granted Kirchhoff's law on thermal radiation, as I modified in my paper on atmospherical radiation. In passing, it was a claim that an American female researcher, Eunice Foote, had observed the heat absorption by gases, including CO2, 4 years earlier than Tyndall. However, her measurements were done by simply using sun rays as her radiation source. From this diagram, you can see that all of the three CO2 absorption peaks could be measured by using sonar radiation. Thus, it is clear Foote's observation cannot be interpreted as a CO2 absorption at 15 micron from the terrestrial radiation. As a result, Tyndall is still the first. Similarly, many online experimental demos on CO2 absorption are irrelevant to the unique CO2 infrared absorption at 15 micron because they didn't use appropriate infrared source.
Shine two heat lamps of equal intensity at equal distance onto each one. Within minutes, you will see the temperature of the bottle with the carbon dioxide in it rising faster and higher.
Well, I will talk about this issue soon. Unfortunately, it would appear Tyndall had not published any papers on gas absorption and emission after his first experiment, before he was killed by his dear wife by accident. Thank you for your watching. Please subscribe and make comments below. Also, please ensure the bell is activated so that you wouldn't miss any of my talks on climate physics. See you next time. Goodbye.